Good morning, everyone. Today, let us discuss few important things. These are they used to ask in examination for 2 marks questions, and very rarely they used to ask for 4 marks. These are the topics, but they are very very important in day to day practice. Minimum a graduate should basic doctor should diagnose all these cases. Okay, so let us see one by one those miscellaneous conditions. The first one is impacted wax. Wax also called as cerumen. So let us see what is wax, how it forms, why it forms, what happens if it is there, and how you remove, why to remove. Right, wax is, it is composed of secretion of sebaceous glands, ceruminous glands, hair, desquamated epithelial debris, keratin, and sometimes duct also. So this sebaceous and ceruminous glands, mainly these ceruminous glands are modified sweat glands. This is important MCQ. Ceruminous glands are modified sweat glands. Yes, these glands, they open into the surface of the hair follicles. You have hair follicles in the outer external rotator canal, right? Isn't it? So these ceruminous glands, they open into the surface of the hair follicles. Okay, and these sebaceous glands, they provide fluid rich in fatty acids, and the secretions of the ceruminous glands, they are rich in lipids. Again, this is also important MCQ. Sebaceous glands, they produce the fluid that is rich in fatty acids, and ceruminous glands, they produce liquid which is rich in lipids and pigment granules also. So secretions of these sebaceous and ceruminous glands together, they mix along with the desquamated epithelium in the external rotator canal and keratin sheds, and they form deep into the external rotator canal, and it formed as wax. Okay, so wax contains ceruminous and sebaceous gland secretions along with desquamated epithelial cells and along with sometimes duct also. Here I want to tell you one important thing is the wax, it has a protective function. Why? Because it lubricates the external rotator canal. Okay, any foreign bodies or any duct or any dust that is if enter into the ear canal, it trapped. And the most important thing is it maintains the pH of the external rotator canal. So it gives the acidic pH to the external rotator canal. In acidic pH, the bacteria or virus, whatever it is there, it is they can't live. Okay, if anything disturbances, if you try to remove, disturb the external rotator canal, if anything, any infection or in or whatever the reason, if any this harmony, if it is disturbed, these external rotator canal pH will shift to alkali, and that alkali environment is favorable for the microorganisms. Then infection and later on purulent material will start in the external rotator canal. Okay, but in normal conditions only a small amount of wax is secreted. So every people they have wax in the ear external rotator canal. Generally the amount is very less. Okay, and which is dried up, and it also expelled with the desquamated epithelium cells, and the movement is always due to jaw movements or your chewing movements or whatever the movement of the surrounding structures, it causes expelling of the contents of the external rotator canal into the environment to outside. Okay, few people they sweat more, few people they have oily skin. Okay, they sweat more, and vice versa, they have activity of the seruminous glands are very high, and that's why they have a excessive wax. Okay, and this excessive wax, it is secreted. The more wax is produced rather than the when compared to the amount of expelled wax. Okay, and that is secreted and deposited into the exoneurotic canal. And few factors like few people, they have a narrow exoneurotic canal and very tortuous exoneurotic canal. Okay, in those cases also it is very difficult to expel. Okay, and stiff hair, and if you have any abnormalities in the exoneurotic canal like bony exostosis, means exostosis means there is a bony overgrowth in the exoneurotic canal which narrows the exoneurotic canal. So medial to the exostosis you will be having accumulation of the wax which leads to dried up, and later on it may get impacted. So now you know the causes for impacted wax, right? So excessive production and due to abnormalities in the exoneurotic canal, and few may have a what do you call hairy oily skin. Due to excessive activity of the seruminous glands, you will be having impacted wax. These wax accumulated and later on it dried up and it is impacted inside. Okay, right. These patient, due to impaction of the wax, there is a problem with conduction of the sound. So this patient will present with oral fullness and a sense of blocked ear and hard of hearing. Okay. Sometimes, very rarely, these patients may present with ringing sensation in the ear also. Ringing sensation in the ear also. Okay. Right. A very interesting case that if there is an impacted wax, sometimes they may be having a cough. Why? Because these impacted wax, they stimulate the which nerve? Yeah, auricular branch of vagus, that is Arnold nerve. Okay, but it is very rare cases. Okay. Here the one more problem is with the wax. If you take bath and if you are doing a swimming, okay, in those cases these water will enter into the exoneurotic canal and you will be having these wax. It will take the, it will absorb the water content, okay, and these wax will swell up and it causes severe pain. This is the most common presentation where children and few adult people, they present to the OPD. Okay, this is long-standing impacted wax. Again, it may ulcerate the meatal skin, and sometimes it is it may cause formation of the granulations also. Okay, right. Yes. So if the patient comes to you with these symptoms, you should get relief from these symptoms. So what you need to do, okay, you should remove that wax. Okay, how you remove? Right. The technique is called, you know, oral syringing. Okay. So this is the oral syringe. Okay. Right. How you do? Right. The patient is seated with the ear to be syringed towards the examiner, right? So you should face the whichever the ear you want to remove the wax, and towel placed around the neck. Why? Because you should not, the water may spill out, so his or her dress may, it may become problem. That's why you need to wrap it. A kidney tray, you can see in the photograph, a kidney tray is placed over the shoulder and you take the fluid or water. See, the whatever the irrigating fluid, that should be normal to the body temperature. If it is very hot, you will have injuries and giddiness. If you irrigate very cold fluid, the patient will have giddiness and she will lost consciousness there itself. Okay? Right. So first of all, pinna is pulled upwards and backwards to make the ear canal straight and introduce the ear syringe that is always directed posterior superior to the explanatory canal. This is MCQ. Okay? Posterior superior wall of the explanatory canal. This is MCQ. Right? Which wall you should be, oral syringe should be directed to which direction? Anterior inferior, anterior posterior, posterior inferior, like that they will ask. This is important MCQ. Even in AIIMS exam also they ask. It is posterior superior. This is very small MCQ. Okay, these type of questions you should not make mistakes. Okay, right. And take the water in the oral syringe and push it. Okay, the build-up pressure, whatever along with the water, it will come out along with the wax. It makes to expel the wax. Okay, right. Here, one thing I want to tell that you just pull the pinna, and you should make the space between the wax and external artery canal. So the water is directed towards the back side of the wax. So that's why, in those cases, the water will hit the back side of the wax and it will come out to outside along with the wax. Okay. If there is no space, you will push the wax along with the water again into the deep to the external artery canal. So this is important point here. Okay. Right, create a space between wax and metal wall and do the jet of the water. Okay, right. Each time, first you should syringe it and again examine. Syringe it and examine. Why? Because how much pressure and which direction you need to do all this, to calculate all this. Okay. I still remember when I, you know, there is a hard impacted wax when I started my clinical practice outside. A patient came to me with the wax. I want to remove that wax. And he also insisted me to remove that wax, very hard wax. I tried to keep on pushing the water inside the ear. The wax didn't come to outside, but the water came from nose. Means what? The water ejected it directly into the tympanic membrane and he had a perforation of the tympanic membrane and that water came via the eustachian tube to the nose. So that is my experience. Okay, first. Right, so that's why unnecessary syringing you should avoid. Syringe it, examine. Syringe it and examine. Okay, right. And don't forget, at the end of the procedure, you should look up for the ear canal and tympanic membrane. It should be inspected and the ear canal should be dried up with the dry mop. Okay? Right. Here you should note any ulcerations in the external artery canal. Why? Because this impacted wax, it may sometimes may ulcerate the external artery canal also due to pressure. If you find any ulcerations, then you should apply the ointment, antibiotic ointment. Okay. Here, I told you now, the water should be body temperature. If it is very cold, he will get, vertigo. Right? Here, one more important point is that patient might be having CSVM, right? A patient already known case of CSVM with a very big tympanic membrane perforation with impacted wax. If he comes to you, if you do syringe, and that wax will go into the middle ear and there it will be impact. At that time, you need to remove that wax under general anesthesia. Okay. So you should take the prior history before you commit any syringing. Okay. Right. Sometimes now I discuss. I mean, now if the situation comes like this, you cannot do a syringing due to you have a suspected perforation in the tympanic membrane or some disease. Okay. If you feel that syringing is hazardous, then you can take the wax with the instrument also. Okay. And the instrumentation, please do remember, it should be with under direction only, under the vision only. Okay. Under the, if it is microscope, it is very well. Why? Because if you are removing under the microscope, your both hands will be free and you can manipulate the instrument very, very well. With one ear, you can retract the pinna, with one ear, another ear, and one hand, you can retract the pinna, another hand, you can remove the wax. Okay. Here also, the most commonly used instrument is Jobson Horn probe. The probe is introduced to beyond the wax and you should pull the, drag the wax. Okay. Right. Here I want to tell one more important thing here. If the wax is very hot, if you are not able to remove either means, then you can do dissolve it. Okay, you can dissolve the wax and you can remove. So here the important point is, what are the waxolytic drugs? With what drugs you can remove or you can melt the wax? After melting or after making the hard wax into the liquid, it is very easy to do a syringing, or you can do, or you can remove with that, with a suction also. With suction, it can remove everything. So what are the waxolytic drugs? That is very important here. It is, you can do with a 5% sodium bicarbonate along with the glycerin and water. Okay. And hydrogen peroxide, it is also a waxolytic. Liquid paraffin, that is also a waxolytic. Olive oil, a bit costly. And we have commercial preparations like, you know, D-wax, Soli-wax, these kind of ear drops are there. You can get in from the pharmacy. The ceremoniolytic drugs are, this is very important, MCQ. Para-dichlorobenzene 2%. Okay. The drug is, which is used for wax to dissolve, is para-dichlorobenzene. Para-dichlorobenzene 2%. Okay, it is used as a waxolytic drugs. So now you tell me the waxolytic drugs, that is 5% sodium bicarbonate in glycerin and water, hydrogen peroxide, liquid paraffin, olive oil, and the commercial preparation is para-dichlorobenzene 2%. So this is how you remove the wax. The wax is very, very, very common in daily practice, daily clinical practice. You believe it or not, every day I will get at least one patient out of my OP, whatever it is. Here, daily at least one patient. Sometimes I used to, you know, really I used to get frustrated. Why? Because all the patients, they are wax patients only. Okay, if you sit into the Saturday OPD, all patients are wax only. Why? Because they come to cleaning, ear cleaning on the Saturdays generally. Why? Because the software people are few central government employees, they have holidays on Saturdays. That's why they used to come for oral toilet. Okay? Right. Next. It is something weird, right? That is, yeah, foreign body in the ear. The foreign bodies in the ear, they have very, very significant important. Okay? You have to remove those foreign bodies. Okay? Right. First, what are the types of foreign bodies? Where to give importance? And how to remove all these? It should be depends upon this classification. First thing, non-living. Non-living foreign bodies means children may insert a variety of foreign bodies like, you know, piece of paper, sponge, grains, and most commonly what I encounter in my practice is slate pencil, you know, that eraser, the piece of chalk and metallic balls. Okay? Right. And then in non-living, the adult at the most common is they used to present with the broken end of matchsticks. Okay, they used to scratch the ear and a cotton swabs also. Okay, right. If a kid or a adult, if they present, I mean, they put the foreign bodies in the ear, if it is vegetable foreign bodies like, you know, seeds, all those, they take the water and swell up again, it will impact. Right. Okay. And living foreign bodies, that is flying or crawling insects like mosquitoes, beetles, cockroaches and ants. The most commonly I encountered is ants. Okay. I used to get late nights, early mornings, I used to get calls from the casualties with the foreign body in the ear. Okay? Right. So there are different types of approaches to remove for living and non-living. So let us see one by one. For the living for non-living foreign bodies, you can take it out with the forceps. And in previous slides we discussed about the syringing. You can do a syringing and you can do a suction clearance and you can do a microscopic removal. And sometimes if it is very impacted, that you need to give a incision in the postoral area and enter into the external artery canal and remove it. Okay. The soft and irregular foreign bodies like piece of paper and swabs and sponges, you can remove with the crocodile forceps. Okay. Seed grains and smooth objects where your forceps cannot grasp it, in those cases you can remove it with syringing. Okay. Smooth and hard objects like stainless steel balls, the grasping will be difficult with the forceps. Okay. And sometimes it may injure the tympanic membrane. If you try to remove it, it may go inside. Okay. In those cases, if he is an adult, you remove under, you know, a microscope and under the vision of microscope. If the patient is a kid, then take him to the theater and remove it under general anesthesia. This is again a MCQ. Okay. In a kid, foreign body, remove it under general anesthesia. Why? Because he won't cooperate. Rather than removing the foreign body, you will damage the surrounding structures like tympanic membrane very, very commonly. So that's why don't do don't attempt in the OPD, take him to theater and take it out under the general anesthesia. Okay. Why? Because see, here in this picture he is putting the Jobson Hans probe. Okay, if the patient is a kid, he will never cooperate to you. You may introduce inside it and you can damage the tympanic membrane. Okay, right. The next thing is living foreign bodies. For living foreign bodies, please remember that the crawling or flying foreign body, don't remove it as it is. First kill it. Okay, no attempt should be made to take it out them live. Kill it. How you kill? Kill by instilling the oil if he is in home, or put some spirit, chloroform water. Here in our casualty, what we do, we used to put 4% xylocaine. Okay, 4% xylocaine into the ear. After killing, you can remove by whatever the method, like for forceps, syringing, suction, with microscope. Okay, comfortably you can remove. Okay, right. Yeah, this is again somewhat problematic. Maggots in the ear. Maggots are a larval forms of flies. The details of the maggots, how they form and why they occur, you can discuss in detail when Dr. Nitin Kulkarni sir deal with nasal meiosis. Okay, here that's why there you can deal with in detail. Here I want to tell only outlines. Like the flies may be, you know, they attract to foul smell. When you have a ear discharge, you know, you can reject human beings, but it can attract the flies. They lay eggs inside and they hatch out into the larva. Those larval forms are called as maggots. They are more common in August and September. This is the season, and till October. You will be having severe pain and swelling, sometimes the blood stain discharge. Why? Because they will eat out. Okay, and if you look into the external artery canal is full of maggots crawling inside. If you put the light, they will go inside into the tissues. It is very difficult. Treatment is kill it and take it out. How you kill? You put a pack of chloroform, or you put a pack of turpentine oil. With that smell of turpentine oil, the turpentine oil smell is equal to kerosene smell. With that smell, it will die. Okay. After that, you remove one by one with the forceps. Okay. Right. In these cases, you may be having a very big perforations of the tympanic membrane. So don't remove those maggots with the syringing. Okay, you may seed those maggots to another site into the middle ear. Don't do that. Remove manually, put a turpentine oil pack into the ear manually, one by one with the forceps. If a patient with the maggots either with nose or ear, if he admits to you, it is a festival for you. Why? Because every second hourly you need to sit along with the patient and you need to remove. If you remove one, the another will go inside into the tissues and they will hide. They will play hide and seek. Okay, so that's why every second hourly you need to remove it. Okay, right. Here the importance, the most important thing is oral toilet. Right. One more important entity I want to tell you is, that is keratosis obturans. The collection of A pearly white mass of desquamated epithelial cells into the deep meatus is called as keratosis afterens. What is this pearly white mass? How it forms? Okay. Due to this pearly white mass of desquamated epithelial cells, it will be having a pressure effect and leads to widening of the external anterior canal. Okay. Etiology is most commonly 5 to 20 years of age. It may be sometimes associated with sinusitis and bronchiectasis. Why bronchiectasis? Here my point is, sometimes you will be having an impaired function of the, desquamation and impaired function of the oral cleaning itself. Okay, so that's why you will be having desquamated external anterior canal, and it will, rather than expelling out, it will store there itself. Okay, so the epithelium normally from the surface of the tympanic membrane, it migrates in onto the posterior mitral wall. Okay, so it goes on. Failure of this migration or due to some obstruction, along with these wax and desquamated epithelium, they form into accumulation of these epithelial plugs into the deep external anterior canal and formation of keratosis afterens. Okay, how a patient presents? It's very severe pain, hearing loss, and the same as wax, but you will be having exaggerated symptoms. Okay, on examination you can see a ear canal filled with pearly white mass of keratin, and if you remove this, you can see very wide external anterior canal along with ulceration, sometimes granulations. Here you need to treat it with syringing or instruments, but it is very very difficult to take it out. Okay, that's why if any patient comes to us with keratosis afterens, we post it under general anesthesia and we'll remove it in theater. Okay, or else if the patient don't want theater procedure, and he can periodically he can come on and off to the theater, to the OPD, and he can done. Okay, every time you need to check for the recurrence, as it is a very recurrent thing. And you can instill keratolytic agents like salicylic acid. In the diagram 12, you can observe that there is a very narrowed external anterior canal that is also called as stenosis of the meatus. The stenosis, again, it is a 2 marks question. It can be due to otitis externa, okay, repeated otitis externa, trauma like lacerations, fractures of the tympanic plate, and if you do a surgery, iatrogenic, and burns like chemical and thermal. Okay, the treatment is consist of meatoplasty. Plasty means repair, meato means external anterior canal, meatus. So meatoplasty, repair it. You do a postoral incision, whatever the scar tissue and thickened meatal skin is removed, and bony canal you enlarge it, you drill it. Okay, and you can cover it with a skin graft. Okay, so what I mean to say is, in a simple form, you do surgery and void it. Okay, so here I'll stop. This is very small topic and important topics. 2 marks questions you may encounter in this. So thank you very much.